Hello and welcome to Dual Universe. A couple minutes ago, the NDA dropped and we can finally make videos, and I'm super excited about this. One of the biggest problems new players have is learning how the game works. There are plenty of different tips and tricks in-game, but since the game has been under NDA since it was created, there's not a lot of tutorials. Well, I'm here to fix that. I'm Virtual of Zenith Corporation, and I'm going to show you guys how this game works. It's going to be a brief overview of the game. Some things about the controls, and how you can get started. When you first start in the game, you'll be in a tutorial tower. I can't replay the tutorial tower since I did it already. But you should definitely complete the tutorial. The tutorial gives you important stuff that you're going to need for your future, like the repair tool. And also blueprints for the default speeder, and also the parts for the default speeder. I'll show you guys how all of that stuff works in a bit. So, I'm going to run through all of the controls in the game, at least the ones that are most pertinent. And then in some future videos, I'll have more tutorials on voxelmancy, how the ship was built, for example. Good ship design. Industry. Flying in space. How to mine the most efficiently. Things like that. As you can see, I'm here on Alia's South Pole. You can see the Sanctuary Moon up there, and the moons behind the Sanctuary Moon. When you first spawn, like I said, you should complete the tutorial. Once you complete the tutorial, you'll walk out and you'll see the district in front of you. Now the districts on Alioth are shown in this purple zone. There are 10 main districts on Alioth and then many other markets. The districts on Alioth also correspond to a district on the Sanctuary Moon, and I'll go through how that works. You'll spawn randomly on one of these districts. You'll see when you spawn two big towers in front of you. Those two towers are the market section of the district. To the left is a smaller little tower, kind of looks like a landing gear, and that is the shuttle surface. That takes you to the Sanctuary Moon. You can go up there and click the little button, and that will teleport you and your inventory to the corresponding district on the Sanctuary Moon. Now, past through the markets, the twin towers, you'll find the tutorial area. These tutorials you should probably do later as they're more advanced, very time-consuming, and they sometimes don't work properly. Hopefully I'll be able to help cut down that learning curve and you guys will be able to get started at a running pace. Like I said, these correspond to markets on the district. To open up your map, I clicked F4. You can see the planet is the one you're currently on. If you click system and zone, you can see all of the other planets in the system. On Alioth, I can click it to see the Alioth system and the sanctuary moon. If I click view planet, after a couple seconds, the moon loads. You can see these areas with the red claims around them are districts. And also on the left side of the map, you have some drop-down tabs, points of interest. These are the different districts. Bookmarks. You can create a bookmark by right-clicking, bookmark location. Constructs are the constructs you currently have. You can right-click a construct, fetch, abandon, all of these things, and set as destination, probably the most important one. One thing you should probably know, fetch distance is 126 kilometers. This allows you to grab your ship if it gets stuck from 126 kilometers away. It shouldn't be used to exploit. Resurrection nodes. You should get one, at least I did. If you don't, you can get one from the market or you can craft one. These allow you to respawn. Your inventory will be wiped when you respawn. So make sure you don't have anything in your inventory. These are very useful just in case you get in trouble, like you die in PvP. You can respawn at your node in your ship or options like that. And this tab allows you to see the resurrection nodes that you have. Warp beacons, we currently don't have any of these, but these would be items that are placed around in space, allowing us to use the warp drive to get to a space station that's out in the middle of nowhere. Now more information on the territories. You must have a territory to build a static construct. There are three different types of constructs, and I'll explain those later. You have to have the territory, so the first thing you should do, you should place your STU, Sanctuary Territory Unit, and you get these from the tutorial. Once again, make sure you get your STU, don't leave the tutorial without getting the unit. Once you spawn on the market, you can place down your speeder, or you can just simply run to the nearest unclaimed tile, claim the tile. What many people do when they claim the tile is they build a small factory, allowing them to build a TCU. The TCUs allow you to claim territories on any planet on the map. Reasons you might want to go to planet are different ore. You can see that in the information tab on the right side of the screen. So bauxite, coal, for example, blah blah blah. Each tier of the ore, and I'll go through the different tiers. Each planet varies in gravity, atmospheric density, terrain, color, many different things like that. And once again, you can click the planet to view it. We'll let this one load. This has an enormous fissure down the middle. Very, very beautiful to see. Definitely worth visiting. So, once you have your TCU, you can choose anywhere in the map that you would like to go. Now we'll go ahead and start running through the basic controls, the basic tools, things like that. Now for more advanced tutorials, like I said, I'll have more videos on those, like build mode. That would take 30 minutes at least to go through the build mode tools, so we won't be covering that in this video. This is just the basic things. One thing that you should always remember is that Alt does the opposite. And I'll clarify that more as we go along. Now there are certain rocks on the ground that you can mine with your number one tool. Number one is Harvest Tool, and it allows you to pick up these rocks. These rocks have all of the tier 1 ores and a couple of the tier 2 ores, and like I said, I'll go through the different tiers in a second. Depending on the color of the rock depends on the ore, so this one, for example, is bauxite, and this one is carbon. To mine it, raycast it, and hold down your click. Currently the server's being pretty slow since we literally just, since the server literally just opened. But as you can see, when I click, I get 20 liters of carbon. They're all 20 liters. Actually, unlink from my container. Now I'll go ahead and get enough of this to refine it. Yeah, man, hopefully the server gets a little bit faster. But this is what happens a couple minutes into beta. Everybody's on, everybody's logging on at the same time. The server is bound to have a few issues. You'll have to bear with me on that. So now I have 60 liters of coal in my inventory. If I click K and I type in carbon, because that is what coal turns into, I can find the pure carbon at the bottom of the list. I can click pure carbon, and I can select how much I would like. Now, unfortunately, I need just a little bit more, so we're going to find one more rock and mine it. Alright, so once I click K, I can select the amount of batch. I want to make one, and I'm going to add to queue. Now, carbon has some output ingredients. You'll get the carbon from the coal, but also as you refine it, you'll gain pure oxygen and pure hydrogen. Both of these things can be used to make nitron fuel. Nitron fuel is atmospheric fuel. It works in the atmosphere. Other fuels, such as kurgan, space fuel, can be made from the same things. However, you shouldn't worry about holding on to your hydrogen and oxygen, as they can just be refined from the atmosphere. If I could spell hydrogen, that would be great. So pure hydrogen, for example, I can select the batch amount, and I can craft it. Super simple. But as you can see, now that the crafting is finished, we have 45 liters of carbon, we have a little bit of extra oxygen, and some pure hydrogen. And once you have enough of all of these things, you can make your atmospheric fuel. You should get some atmospheric fuel from the tutorial when you first start, and that can be used to power your speeder. Now we'll move on to the number 2 tool, which goes in conjunction with the number 3 tool. The number 2 tool, as it says on the bottom, is the mine tool. You can hold Control and scroll to change the size of the mine tool. As you might expect, Alt does the opposite, like I explained. If you have this turned on in your inventory, it allows you to pick up non-precious items. For example, the dirt off the ground. Looks like we're going to get another pending operation. Oh, it worked, okay. Now that I have some dirt in my inventory, what I did to do this, it's already there, but I'll show you once again. I took the tundra item, and I dragged it into the quick access bar. Now once it's in the quick access bar, you can scroll between the different items. For example, if I added this version of tundra, I can select it as well. Now let's say I want to build a little thing, I can lower down the size of my sphere, hold Alt, and I can click. And that will place the tundra voxels here on the planet. Pretty neat little system, not super useful, however, it's there. The number 3 tool is the scanner. It allows you to see underground ores. Underground ores are more of a later in the game thing. Like a couple days into the game, you're gonna run out of these things. Like these won't be giving you enough ore, and you'll be able to use your ore scanner to find large deposits underground. If I click tab, it brings up a menu, and also if I click on the scanner with my mouse, it pulls up the different tiers of the ores. All of these tiers vary in their rarity and also their depth, tier 1 being the least rare and the highest in altitude, tier 5, as you might expect, being much deeper, 2 kilometers even in some cases. I can filter these by clicking the entire tier, or just clicking off something that I would like. As you can see on the graph here, when I turn off hematite, the dark blue line goes away. On the topic of the colors, the color is the density. Iron, as you might expect, is denser than coal. Coal is a lighter line, iron is a darker line. Something that's very dense, like gold for example, has a red line because it's extremely dense. Now I'll have a more detailed tutorial going over how to use the scanner and the most effective way to mine with it. Now I'll go ahead and exit out of this menu and I'll show you the number 4 tool. This is a short range directional scanner, and just like the number 3 tool, it has a selectable size circle. Now the size that is selectable is affected by talents, and I'll go into the talents in just a bit, but for now use your mind tool because the size is much higher. But this allows you to look around, and if you are near an ore deposit, 30 meters for example, a little bar and an audio feedback will come up between the heavy and the light section. And like I said, depending on the color, that depends on the density. Once you find it with the directional scanner, you can pull out your number 2 tool, mine toward it, and go. Now once you get to the ore with your actual number 2 tool, you'll hold down your click until the circuit grows, and then you click again to mine the actual ore, right? The middle mouse button can be used to auto mine. If I click the middle mouse button, I'm not holding anything, it just digs for me, for example. And the same can be done with all of these tools. And number 5 is the deploy tool, and the one you're going to need almost immediately. This allows you to deploy core units and to deploy your STU and TCU. To select what you would like to deploy, take from your inventory an item, for example, my XS dynamic core or an S dynamic core, and you can use your scroll wheel just to select between them. As you can see, when I am inside of the build zone, the core becomes blue and I'm allowed to place it. There are multiple ways to maneuver the core. One of the ways that we can talk about is R and scroll. That allows you to rotate. T and scroll allows you to change the altitude. If you just move your mouse around, you can see that it just moves around to the ground. Now, if you'd like a more precise method of maneuvering, you can use page up and page down. And this allows me to walk around while the core is in place. I can also use the arrow keys to translate it laterally. You must have a core expertise. You must have a core unit upgrade already if you would like to place an organization core. For example, when you first start, you will be allowed to own 3 constructs, or sorry, it's 2 constructs, I think. Once you upgrade your architect skill, like I'll show you in just a bit, you'll be able to own more constructs. If you'd like to place a core for the org, you must have an open core available, even though it won't use the slot. The number 6 tool is the fuel tool. I don't currently have any on me, but there are 3 different types of fuel. We have the nitron fuel, which is used to power these engines. These are atmospheric engines. The Kurgan fuel, which is used to power space engines and vertical boosters. And this Xeron fuel, which is used to power rocket engines. And if you get anything from this video, remember that Alt does the opposite. If I move over to my fuel tank and hold Alt on my fuel tank, I'll be able to remove fuel from the tank. To fill up the tank, I just hold down my click, and the fuel goes back into the tank. Just like so. Space fuel is the same way. Currently the server's lagging pretty bad. But you can see how that is. So the fuel tool's simple. It allows you to refuel your ship. The number 7 tool is the maneuver tool. When you first start, you're bound to run into a tree with your hovercraft. If that happens, not to worry. Just grab your number 7 tool, raycast the construct, and click. And this will allow you to drag the construct around with your mouse. Use WASD and E and Q to rotate the construct, and then also the scroll wheel to move it farther and closer to yourself. Keep in mind that there's a range at which you can grab constructs, so if you put the construct too far away or too high above you, you won't be able to grab it. So when you are moving your construct, make sure that it's close to the ground so that you can grab it once again. As you might expect, in the name, dynamic constructs are the only ones that can maneuver. The other type of constructs are static constructs, which are placed as bases on the ground, and then space constructs, which are space stations in orbit. Space constructs generate their own gravity. The color is also makes sense as well. So we have the orange is going to be static, blue is going to be dynamic, and then I don't have any on me, but purple is space. Currently there's a bug with how it looks, so the dynamic and static are a bit backwards. Now if you click V, you'll be able to see the different constructs on your map. When you're at the market, it'll be covered with these little blue markers. Furthermore, if you look on your mini map in the top right corner, you'll be able to see your player, your waypoints, north, east, southwest, and then also the constructs around you. Now if you'd like to change what shows up on your V menu, you can hold Alt and click V. This allows you to select things. For example, if I want to see the territory tiles on Alioth, I turn that on, and now I can see the grid on Alioth. This is helpful for mining. So as we can see, that's how the V menu works. Control F9 also hides your HUD so you can get cool screenshots. We'll continue to move on through the tools. Number 8 is your Deploy Construct tool. It allows you to place blueprints. Once again, you can grab a blueprint from your inventory, drop it into your quick access bar, and then use your scroll wheel to go through it. If you have enough of the item that the construct requires, the build zone will turn blue and you'll be able to click in place. I currently don't have enough material. To see how much material you have, all you have to do is right-click the blueprint in your inventory and click Inspect Item. This allows you to see the elements first and then the voxels down at the bottom of the list. You must have all of these things before you can place the blueprint. When you first get your starter speeder, you'll get a blueprint and a bunch of parts. You want to take that blueprint from your inventory, put it into the number 8 tools quick access bar, and place the speeder at the location that you desire. Number 9 is the repair tool that you get from the tutorial. You can employ scrap in the repair tool to repair items. Now for example, to make scrap, I have to use a refined ore. I have a little bit of carbon, but not quite enough, but in my link container I do have enough, and I'll show you how this works. So 105 carbon I have. If I go here and click and type in carbon scrap shows up. I can make one batch, add to queue, and in my nanocrafter the carbon scrap will craft. If I open my inventory, I can grab this carbon scrap, move it into my quick access bar, and with this I can repair items. I just hold onto the item, and as you can see, slowly the health points of the item go back up and the item repairs. What I did to get up into my ship was I clicked B. B is build mode, and it comes with its own set of tools. In a later video, I'll explain what all of these tools do, and then in a much later video from that, I'll explain how to use them to make a beautiful ship like the one I'm in now. That is the gist of the repair tool. Now there are a lot of other pretty obvious controls, like L for your light, double tap W to run, hold shift to run slowly, and just W to walk. But if you click tab, you can see there's a huge menu on the side. Each of these menu things have hotkeys, at least for the most part. Avatar doesn't, but you can click avatar, see yourself, and whatever. So we'll go ahead and go through the F keys, starting with the codex. So there are a couple hint things. The codex is great for learning more about the game. It's worth giving a read, especially if you get stuck on something. You can be like, oh, I don't know how RDMS works. Let's click RDMS, and this will help you learn how RDMS works. That's really helpful, especially if there are things that I don't cover, which inevitably there are. Number 2 is your talents. Definitely one of the most important menus that we have. There are a lot of different talents that you have in your F2 menu. For example, mining and inventory, industry, crafting, so on and so forth. I'm currently in the mining and inventory spec, and in here I have more drop-down menus. If I clicked on Terraformer and click one of these items, I can see the amount of points that are required. You should always have a queue set up because you get 90 talent points per second with a queue, and only 60 if you don't have a queue set up. To queue something, Just click on the thing you would like, queue all required, and they will show up in your menu. Now you can drag these around to wherever you would like to set different priorities. Over time, they will automatically finish, and when they finish, you'll have a notification in the bottom. The next menu that we're going to talk about is the F3 menu. This is the organization menu. It allows you to join an organization, see information on organization, and other things. If I click the search bar here, I can search my organization in the search filters term, click my organization, and view things like the manifesto, member count, etc. Things like this. There's also other filters that you can use here to find an organization that you would like. Most organizations prefer that you contact them via Discord because a lot of them have a little bit of a recruiting process, like a short interview, for example. If I click on an organization that I am in, my organization, Zenith Corporation, I can see things like the members in the corporation, the people who are looking to be recruited, info, things like that, and posts. All of these things can also be seen on the Dual Universe website, but we won't get into that here. Furthermore, you can create your own organization if you would like, and you have to use an original tag and name. Moving on to the F4 menu, we've already used this multiple times. It is the map. I think I went through most of these things, but I'll show you once again. This button centers the position. Super useful. This button copies coordinates to clipboard. When you have coordinates copied to the clipboard, you want to go into local chat by clicking enter, control V the coordinates, and then right click and set as destination. That's how you set destination from coordinates that are posted in Discord, for example. Coming back to the map, we can see the bookmarks. To create a bookmark, click set as bookmark. That's pretty easy. Points of interest are things like the districts. These change per planet you're on. Resurrection nodes are the places where you can respawn that you've already placed. You should get these when you start. If you don't, you can buy one from the market or craft it in an industry. Warp beacons we don't have yet, but this allows your warp drive to send you to places other than the planets, for example, a space station between Alioth and Jago. Moving on to the F5, this is a helpful hints thing. You can go through here also to learn more about the elements and items like that. I'm not going to go through this because it's a very long list, but if you get confused on something, it's definitely worth doing so via the search bar at top. F6 is achievements. They don't really do anything, but it's cool when you get one. If you get an achievement, the light turns on and you get a certain XP amount. XP is pretty much useless. I won't spend a lot of time on here, but if you're interested, you can look through here and see the different achievements that you can get. The F7 menu is called RDMS, and I will probably have a separate video for RDMS because it's so complicated. If I click on my name at the top, this is the permissions for my construct. I can add a specific tag or use a tag of a construct that I've already built. This is also how you give permissions to your organization or other people of your in your territory tile. Rights are the different rights that you can add to people. Deploy item, for example, repair construct, use element, things like that you will be able to add. Actors are groups. For example, if I go to my corporation, go to actors, and go to managers, you can see the people that I have added as a manager. To add someone else, all I have to do is type in their name, click them, and add them again. This adds them to the actor. Now, the actors are used in policies. A policy is something that you create with the create button, and it allows you to select an actor, either just a player or an existing actor that you've created via the actor tab, and give the actor rights. For example, Zenith Corporation has these rights on Zenith Base 1. I can also select custom tags or tags of ships that I own. To add a tag to a ship that you own, you just right-click it, advanced, set construct rights, and that's what you can do there. A more simple version of the RDMS that isn't quite as useful but is much quicker is just share construct with organization, your organization. You can also share construct with nearby player if they are standing next to you. So if you need to share your construct with a friend, all you have to do is have them stand next to you and click their name. Moving on to the friends section, if you click tab, you can actually go to contacts right there. To add a contact, you click add contact. Online contacts, you can click and you can lock them. This shows their location. You can also start PMs with them, but another way to start a DM is with slash W. If I wanted to start a DM, I could do slash W, the player name, and the message, for example. And this will open up a private DM. When you're standing on a construct, you will have a channel for the construct. If you're in an organization, you have a channel for the organization. Support channel is basically the public channel. Local is within a couple tiles of you. Tutorial is the channel that the robot will talk to you when you first start. And Lua is logs. Alright, what is next? I think that F7 was the very last thing. And with that, that is the basics of some of the basic controls that we have here. I'll go ahead and show you what it looks like to fly a ship. This is a hover seat. You will want to run default auto configure and pilot flying construct. If you pilot ground construct, the auto configure will fly like a hovercraft. On your default hovercraft, you can move the wings horizontally to allow for vertical lift, and you can set as a pilot flying construct and be able to fly like an aircraft. This is very useful if you want to get around quickly. This one is like that. I also have a gunner seat here where a gunner can sit and use the guns. I'll have a separate PvP tutorial on this. But as you can see, this allows you to lock and fire at enemies. The X button closes the seat, but the insert button puts you in third person. As you can see on the right, I have a very busy HUD, and I'll go ahead and go through there quickly. The reason it's so busy is because the ship is so big. The rocket fuel, 0%, those are the engines at the back. Warp drive, I have it set at Jago to set a warp point. Click the planet, and click set as warp point. You can see the distance. 474 SU. 1 SU is 200 kilometers, and like I said, the maximum fetch distance is 126 kilometers. Get that? Gyroscope is useful for Lua programming, but not much else from that. The radar works in space in the PvP zone and allows you to identify and see other targets up to 400 kilometers away. Space fuel shows the percentage and the estimated time on your fuel. The time isn't always accurate. It takes time to stabilize. The periscope is what you will see when you identify a target in the radar. It gives you a view of the ship from a distance. Atmospheric fuel percentage is the same as the space and rocket fuel percentage, except for the atmospheric fuel tanks. As you can see, I have two cannons. They are extra small cannons at the very right side, and if I click tab and right click those, I can fire them when I'm in space and PvP zone. Now, in the very top is the most important tab. It shows you the braking, axes, your throttle position, cruise control, thrust, atmosphere, and a bunch of other things you can scroll through. If I click this and scroll, I can scroll. So I click tab to allow myself to look at the HUD and also cruise control and travel mode. Travel mode's what you'll use most often. Cruise control is not super useful. To move around, it's the same thing. WASD, Q and E. Space activates your boosters and boosts you up a bit. And when you throttle up, that increases the thrust of the engines. The engines have a warm-up time. The bigger the engine, the longer the warm-up time. There's also skills that allow you to warm up the engine slower. Now, if I cycle through X, there are three different modes. The first one is an instantaneous trajectory. The third one is forces acting on the ship. So as I move my adjusters, you can see that there are forces. And as the wings gain lift, you can see that they are giving me a force down to hold me up. If I click X once again, I have a long trajectory. And this trajectory is useful for getting into orbit. Orbit is similar to Kerbal Space Program. There is actual orbital mechanics, although the planets don't move, so slingshots are impossible. As you might expect, slowing down shortens your trajectory, and speeding up lengthens it. You can go into orbit of Alioth and sit there indefinitely, as long as there's no atmospheric resistance. On Alioth, your space engines turn on at 3,500 meters. When you land a ship, you don't want to come down straight. You want to come down at a nice shallow angle so that your wings do most of the work. The control key activates your brakes. There are two different types of brakes: atmospheric brakes, air brakes, and space brakes, aka retro rocket brakes. When I land, I'm going to click space to hold myself up and then hold control to slow down. If you want to brake in space, you must have the space brake. If you want to click brake in atmosphere, you have to have the air brake. You can see the two different types of brakes on the bottom. On the left is the space brake, on the right is the atmospheric air brake. That is a short rundown of some basic things in Dual Universe. I'll have more complicated tutorials coming later, and hopefully this will be helpful for you guys. If you need any help, feel free to PM me at virtual on the official Dual Universe Discord server. Thanks for watching. Signing off.